Welcome to another episode of the Primal Edge Health Podcast. I'm Tristan. You can find more at www.primaledgehealth.com. This is a very special episode where I'm talking to Phil Escott. Now, Phil has a book that's going to be released soon. And in this episode, we get pretty deep into some of the philosophical aspects of healing. We talk about how healing is not just a physical endeavor. This is a very important episode. There's a lot of gems in here, and if anybody wants to contact Phil or find out more about his book that's pending release, you can find it at www.pureactivity.net. Now, I hope you enjoy the podcast. You can find more stuff like this at www.primaledgehealth.com. Enjoy. Phil got in touch with me over a year ago, and we were talking a little bit about some autoimmune conditions that he had dealt with, and I wanted to have Phil on an episode of the podcast, and he mentioned he was writing a book. So I decided maybe it's better to wait until his book is ready to publish. And the other day, Phil actually sent me a copy of his book, which I greatly appreciate. He's not published it yet. I think you're in the editing phase still, right?
Yeah, here and there, mucking about with little bits of it. When the opinions come back.
Sanitizing it for us masses. But I've been reading through it, and it's really amazing. He called his book Arthritis, The Greatest Thing That Ever Happened to Me. And the book is about Phil's personal journey of dealing with an autoimmune condition, which manifested in just kind of a myriad of really intense and painful and sometimes frightening symptoms. Phil kind of gets into a lot of the other aspects that people seem to bypass when talking about their successful dealings with autoimmune conditions, autoimmune diseases. Now, Phil was dealing with a highly inflammatory acute arthritis, as well as some gut issues and all kinds of other things. And Phil gets into the ketogenic type diet that he utilized to lower inflammation and get through this, as well as a lot of the mistakes that he made along the way. But what I think was so important, he got really deep into a lot of the emotional, mental, and spiritual aspects of dealing with a chronic disease or an autoimmune condition. I think this is greatly overlooked, is the fact that not all healing is physical. Not all healing has to do with eat this food, don't eat this food, that there's a lot more going on that can affect us. And this has been proven scientifically that our emotional states, our mental states can affect gut bacteria, can affect the balance of our immune system. And I really enjoy starting to have on more guests such as Phil, who can talk about their own personal experiences, their personal journeys. He did an interview on a YouTube channel called Buddha at the Gas Pump. And he sent me this interview, and I thought it was great. I watched a few of the other interviews on this channel, and I actually thought that Phil's was the best one on there. I mean, he came off so humble and so genuine in this interview. Let's get right into it, Phil. How was arthritis one of the greatest things that ever happened to you?
Well, I think at the time when you're diagnosed, it's obviously the most horrendous thing. But what's so great, I think, about illness is people either go running to the docs, which we often do. And even if we get to a path of our own after some time, we get panicked. We run to the docs. We think they'll have a pill that'll cure it in a week. And it really isn't the case. You start to feel very very disillusioned with them, you know. I mean, it often comes across in my writings, and I think people say that I'm very angry with doctors or I'm very upset with the medical system. I'm not at all. I think 99% of doctors mean incredibly well, and they just have these resources to hand, you know, the pharmaceutical kind of side of things. I think I'm not angry with anybody. I think the pharmaceutical thing's just trying to make money. The docs are just employed and taught in that way. But they don't, miracles that they do with surgery and trauma medicine, they just don't have a lot to offer for autoimmune conditions, chronic stuff, cancer, diabetes. So I just had to start looking. And in that looking, in that huge journey, I came out the other side of it an awful lot better than I went in. And you have to go through the emotional sides and mop these things up, you know, these ridiculous ways that you think and the things that we do to ourselves. It's always what we do to ourselves, coming from the subtle to the gross. As we start kicking against life, if you like, you know, on so many little subtle levels and gross levels, from eating pizza to, you know, moaning about our life situation, all of these things, I think eventually add up and trigger our genetics. And autoimmune conditions are huge now, because we tend to dislike our lives and not value what's going on. And so the body tends to sort of attack its own tissues. And I think this is a side that the docs don't really look at very much. They're starting to, you know, as you can see, with so many of the docs are coming across, you see them appearing on the fringes of the paleo movement and whatever. And, you know, Terry Walls, Natasha Campbell McBride, Jack Cruz, and they've all fixed themselves or relatives, and it's not been from their medical training. So you often find that once you've done that, it gives you a great sense of getting your power back, if you like. But it also takes you to extraordinary places. You can't fail to come through something like that and not come out better the other side. All pain is growing pain, I think.
Yeah, and that really comes across in your book. I can't wait till it's actually published and other people can read it. I hope you self-publish it, because you should. This book needs to get out there. I know you had some publishers that were courting you, and they need to get off the fence and get this book out there, because I think it could really help a lot of people. So
it's difficult for the publishers, because a lot of them do have kind of mainstream books. And then the other objection is that there's somebody who's a layman, you know, who's writing this thing. But to me, when you look at the docs who've actually written about autoimmunity, they've done it from their own studies, because everybody knows that docs have 1 or 2 days diet training, you know, and it's usually that low fat, high fiber business or whatever, you know, sometime in their 7 years. And so I don't see them as really experts on getting rid of autoimmunity, because they don't. They're there to cover up the symptoms. And, you know, again, people think that I think this is some kind of evil thing. I don't. Everything has its place. But if you really do feel that you want to get rid of it, there should be these options. You know, there's a local hospital here, a hospital of rheumatology. And I haven't been there forever. You know, you go in there and the people all waiting are looking very sick. They're not well at all. They're fat. They're gray skinned. They're, you know, stuff's going on. They're full of chemicals. And it's such a shame. But you walk in and the first thing you smell is toast. You know, they've got this kind of cafe selling cakes and toast. And they say, oh, would you like something to eat? Would you like a slice of toast? And you're like, I'm in a hospital of rheumatology. Hello. You know,
yeah.
Very strange.
A lot of this stuff is not, I mean, to most people, to associate diet with autoimmune conditions is completely crazy. I mean, a lot of, like you said, I mean, I don't think it's a problem with doctors not wanting to heal people. I think it's a problem of the education of the medical establishment catching up to where science is going, and science catching up to itself. Because, I mean, you have people like you who through a myriad of interventions of lifestyle and diet are able to cure these autoimmune conditions, or to at least cut them a lot closer to the root than we're getting with just pharmaceutical drugs. And I mean, to completely discount all these N of one experiments that people like you are doing is a little bit ridiculous. And to expect everything to be a randomly controlled double blind study, I mean, you're probably not going to find a double blind study showing that there could be a connection between rheumatoid arthritis or, you know, debilitating autoimmune conditions such as you dealt with, and an allergic reaction to some inflammatory foods that maybe shouldn't be in certain people's diets. First of all, let's talk a little bit about what was it that you were actually dealing with? I mean, what was your initial diagnosis? How did you come about this? How did you first realize it? And what were the symptoms that manifested for you?
Right. Well, looking back, you know, it started way back, a good decade or 15 years ago, maybe. But we don't really realize that quite often at the time, because these things start very subtly. It was the end of 2010. It was sort of, I'd just come back from a trip to Thailand, and I'd been there fishing, catching these monstrous beast fish at a friend's fishery out there, extraordinary things. And I came back, and then just one day, one ankle just blew up massively, like it was badly sprained. And then about a week later, the other one did, and then one knee. And it was just, it was extraordinary, you know. For quite a time, I'd been living on You know, these protein pump inhibitors, lansoprazole it was called, these awful things that they give you as soon as they say you have acid reflux. Because any of these things, if you look back 10 years, you can see the digestive system going to pot first. And then it gets through to the other systems in the body, depending on your genetics. You know, it might hit as MS or diabetes or arthritis or whatever, heart disease, whatever your primary genetics are, which don't ever cause the disease. It's just, there's a blueprint of what goes wrong if you cock up. But so I had fevers, I had rashes, I had iritis, often goes with it, you know, where you get this awful inflammatory thing in the eye where you can't refocus without agony. And it's if you leave that, it sends you blind. And that's, again, here's a great thing with the medical community. They save your sight. You put steroid drops in there and it calms it down. But it'll never go away permanently if you don't get to the root cause of it. And taking oral steroids, for example, is so dangerous, as you know. You know, it's not.
You're upsetting the gut microbiome even more, and they're finding that these non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are kind of dangerous for the gut microbiome.
Oh yeah, yeah, and I can see what happened to me, because as my back got more painful, because it started in my back, as my back got more painful, I'd take more ibuprofen, you know, and these anti-inflammatory things, and then they give you the lansoprazole so that it doesn't harm your gut lining, all this kind of thing, which isn't really what's going on. You need to fix the gut. I was living on antacids, and when I got rid of the grains, even my first sort of wrong turn, which was a slight right turn after what I was eating, but we're getting into the whole raw veganism thing. As soon as the wheat went, I didn't have any more gut issues. I didn't have any more gut issues at all. Of course, then it takes quite a long time to figure out how to calm the joints down. And this is the problem a lot of people get when they're fixing something autoimmune. They take, you know, they get onto maybe the GAPS diet, even if they get onto it quite strict. For anyone who doesn't know, the GAPS diet is Natasha Campbell McBride's gut and psychology syndrome, where she advocates bone broths and probiotics from sauerkraut. And if you get to that, you know, still you can have pain in the joints, but the gut tends to settle down a lot faster. But a lot of people, then they get discouraged, because the doctors, on one hand, they're going for these appointments and they're saying, oh, well, diet won't work, nothing will work.
Yeah.
And so the confidence isn't there. So they take so many wrong turns. So then these processes don't have a chance to heal. Nature's slow to heal. You have to be patient. It takes decades to get this ill. You can't just get well overnight. It doesn't happen. And people expect that because they think a pill will cure them. And the doctor's pills don't cure them, but they expect some other thing to cure them. So all the natural methods get a bad rap as well, because they don't work within a week. And you can't expect...
Yeah, the pills don't work instantly. So then if I go to the health food store and I ask them, I ask the dreadlocks guy who sells weed behind the counter to hook me up with some natural remedies, and they don't work instantly, then it's like, oh, well, nothing works. I'm screwed. I'm going to go back and, you know, get on the drugs that I can at least feel. Yeah, at least I could feel the Oxycontin, you know.
Yeah. And I really sympathize. You know, I went round and round. And so I see people nowadays who have these conditions. And it's amazing to see, like this guy I was saying before you started recording, this guy the other day, he sent me a testimonial of when I'd Skyped with him and just introduced him to all these principles. And people go at their own pace, but this guy did everything at once. He hit the keto diet, you know, the cold thermogenesis, the emotional balancing, everything all at once. And he knocked out inflammatory arthritis in about 6 weeks, which was quite extraordinary. I mean, that's way, way quicker than I managed to do it, because I was there on my own. I didn't have anybody who'd done it. I kind of read a few things. It took me a while to get onto Facebook groups, which people laugh at. You know, doctors go off Facebook groups, but my goodness, these people are coming together and they're recounting their stories, which are very similar, of knocking these things out. And they get down to very low symptoms with the diet, but then you have to go beyond that. As you well know, and you've covered in so many of your podcasts, there's so many disconnects. It's not just food, it's the light, it's the magnetism, it's the water, it's everything. It's just the joy of living, where everybody is going around doing jobs they hate, buying food that kills them, and they just get more and more miserable. And it's no wonder there's this huge explosion in autoimmunity. And I often get accused of sort of having a go at people about wheat or trying to banging on about it. But the thing for me with this is I've always been a rebel. I don't care. If somebody knows how bad wheat is and then they go and have a pizza, I would go, cool, away you go. You know, somebody smokes.
It's not like it's going to affect everybody. You know what I'm saying? I mean, yes, yeah. Not the most ideal food. But just because, you know, this worked for you or this diet works for me or whatever, doesn't mean that every single person must be prescribed to eat this way. And I think people infer that. People like to infer, you know, I mean, it's the internet. So anything that anybody says is taken as an absolute statement directed at everybody in the world. I always have to predicate, like, if I'm, you know, yes, in these videos I promote a keto diet. I don't believe it's that everybody needs to do it. I don't think it's the cure for everything ever. It's just a really important tool that I think people should know about and they can utilize very effectively, especially if they do it in what I would consider to be the right way. So,
I mean, I think if somebody's really balanced in a great place that they love, doing something that they love, they can probably get away with grains perfectly fine, as we probably did for ages when that was okay. But the thing for me is, you know, if somebody's smoking or drinking, or, you know, I'll have the odd drink. That's why I have no abs anymore after these last 18 months. I didn't have to be so strict. I could have some red wine. So, you know, and people do this sort of stuff. They know what it does. It's an informed choice. To me, that's great. I have no problem. I never say to somebody else, stop smoking or anything. It's none of my business. My business isn't either to tell them. It's something I just love to see is people with inflammatory conditions. Somebody might be able to tell them that whole grain, low fat diets are probably not a good idea at that stage. Yeah. And it's such a huge thing. I mean, it can knock out maybe 50% of their symptoms straight away. And the other 50% is perhaps a little more complicated. But you can see that it's to do with the digestion. The first thing I tell people, if they're not on board with the fact that diet can have a tremendous impact on autoimmunity, is to fast. I say, look, just fast, preferably 3 days if you can, 5 if you can, that would be brilliant. More than that, they might get a bit freaked out. I know it's fine as long as you balance the electrolytes to go, you know, quite a few days. There's nothing wrong with that. And you'll find that pretty much any inflammatory condition will go to 10% or less straight away. So it's a good jumping point for them to understand that it is something to do with the diet. And really, don't listen to their doctors that it's hopeless and diet won't work. Because when you stop eating, the inflammation dies down. And that's what's so great about keto, isn't it? Because it mimics so much of the fasting thing. Because you go into keto when you fast anyway. And I think it gives the digestion a rest. It's not, the leaky gut isn't an issue if there's no food in there to leak through. And it's a revelation for a lot of people when suddenly they can walk again and run around after months or years of pain. Yeah, a 5-day fast on that fifth day, probably by the third day, you'll find huge, huge difference. A lot of people don't need to do that. You know, if they understand and they trust anyway, but for somebody who's absolutely cold to it and has no idea, my first thing is to say, give yourself some confidence. Don't eat for a while. Take some water in, balance the electrolytes. And it's amazing what can be done. You know, if the docs could see that, it's quicker. It's as quick as steroids, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
And I think it's really important you mention, you know, that yes, these dietary interventions, you can get like a 50% reduction in symptoms in some people through these simple dietary interventions. But the other 50% is a little bit more complicated. And you mentioned exactly what I have experienced myself and what I've witnessed in a lot of people, and is that it's a whole lifestyle approach. You know, you have to be approaching it from every level. And if you've got bitterness towards life, bitterness towards your job, if you've got kind of a disconnect between your lifeline to life and to the source of life, then you can't expect to be fully healed and to fully enjoy it. And like you said earlier, we kind of dig our own holes. We kind of dig the pits that we walk into. And, you know, I mean, holding on to lifestyles that are counterproductive to our real intention or our real goal. Let's go back to some of the symptoms that were manifesting, because you mentioned arthritis, but in your book and from talking to you before, I know that there's a lot more things, people hear arthritis like, oh man, the guy's joints were hurting a little bit. No big deal.
I know.
This guy looks healthy. Or you were having to get fluid drained from your joints regularly.
Well, yeah, I only had it drained once from the knee, but the ankles were the worst. It was just like they were absolutely full of broken glass. I mean, anybody who's had inflammatory arthritis knows how horrendous it is. It's to the point where you're on the sofa and you just don't want to go to the toilet. You know, you just put it off because it's so painful to get there. But that was the joint side of it. The back was there. The eyes, as I said before, I occasionally would flare up. But you have all kinds of things can go on with me. There's so many unexplained things, like autoimmune can hit it anyway. There was psoriasis. There was all kinds of skin eruptions. There was neuro stuff, twitching, spasming, very odd, lots of
real. You mentioned almost like really intense neurodegenerative symptoms. Like you were walking into rooms and forget what you were doing. I mean, some of this stuff sounds kind of frightening. But how did this also manifest in other ways in your life, like emotionally and mentally?
It was interesting because a lot of people think that depression hits because you have bad joints, so the depression hits. But you quite often notice a flare-up coming in the depression or the sort of dread and horrible mental aberrations before the joints hit. And so I can see exactly where, for example, Natasha Campbell Bride's coming from, because with her fix the gut, fix autism and attention deficit disorder, depression, schizophrenia, all kinds of things, I was getting all kinds of very bizarre aberrations, yeah. But the brain fog was huge, yeah. Walking into rooms, overflowing sinks, you know, just taps running all over the place, stuff left on the cooker, and yeah, it was a frightening time. It was. I thought, because if you go to Dr. Google and you put in bad joints and you put in twitching and spasming and brain fog, you just come up with Lyme disease. And fishing and whatever. I'd been bitten by ticks. I know I had. And so you think it's Lyme. You see, this. I'd like to whiz past this section in a way, because what a lot of people do, and I did as well, and I won't belittle the time because it went on for quite a long time, is chasing around for diagnosis. You chase around from one place to another. You go to this department, that department. Eventually, you end up with no answers and a bigger cabinet full of drugs. And you don't have any clue what's going on. A rheumatologist, you go up to and you say, listen, why am I twitching and spasming and I've got brain fog? They have no idea. Or at least the two or three I asked had no idea. So I don't think you have to chase these symptoms. If you have a real acute symptom that's absolutely horrendous that needs knocking out, like, you know, if you're in anaphylactic shock or you've got a bone sticking through your leg, of course, it's something that needs to be addressed there immediately. But the thing that's very important with people with autoimmunity is that they, when they get diagnosed, they think, oh, that's when I got it. It goes on for decades. And one of the very important things to do is to just stop chasing symptoms. Have the faith that if you take away the things that are causing a problem, the body heals itself up. And what I noticed, even by cutting the grains out and the pulses and stuff like that and getting onto the raw smoothies and things before I discovered all the keto business, it was starting to knock out a load of the sort of peripheral problems. You know, the brain fogs, the brain fog didn't really go until I got into a load of fish and sort of binged that in. Mm-hmm. But the skin conditions and all kinds of things were clearing up. And the body, you could feel it becoming less confused. The joints was the real big thing. You know, I'd say it was arthritis because that was the thing that really crippled me and made me listen. But here's the other thing, I guess, about having all these symptoms. When you have something autoimmune, I think in this day and age, autoimmunity is actually quite a blessing, because once you understand how to knock the symptoms out, the process of knocking the symptoms out makes you much calmer, much happier, takes you to a place where you're much more in touch with who you are as a human being, gives you confidence to heal yourself. But also, the body never unlearns how to attack itself. It's not like you're suddenly cured.
Right.
You can get the symptoms to zero if you do everything perfectly, but then You see, I'm somebody who has no willpower at all. None. I'm terrible. I have to have some appalling illness before I actually do anything. But then it leads me into being able to have such a sensitive instrument panel that I realize, and it stops me doing all the sort of depravity that I would normally do and trash my body. At times I've gone on real health kicks, but I don't know if it's a Gemini thing. You just go up, down, emotions, crazies. I'm really into this thing. Oh, now I'm into that thing. You know, I'm into tremendously into, I ran my own gym, you know, and I was so into that. I was as fit and healthy as I could be on that diet at that time, sort of 15 years ago. And then I got real unhealthy. I thought, okay, I'm going to go straight to the other thing. And it stops this constant flaking about between things that harm you, things, anything that's attacking you, because we attack ourselves. If we eat even a meal that we know is not particularly good for us, I see that as a bit of an attack. Now, in somebody who's totally balanced, it doesn't matter. Oh, have a big ice cream. What the hell? It doesn't matter. But if you're already autoimmune, the body's already had enough of being attacked. You know, and it kind of makes you stricter than you ever would be before. But I think it's lucky, because all my favorite foods are the keto foods, you know, the meat, the veg, the high fat. So it's no problem for me, really. The eating is no problem whatsoever. It never has been. I've never understood a bread addiction, but I was glad to see the back of it. But it does, it gives you a very sensitive, it's like a kind of Formula One car. You want to really be careful on that accelerator. When you have something that's autoimmune, I feel better than I ever did. I feel tremendous, but I know it takes maintenance on every level. Some things that you fix become permanent fixes and give you more of a, I've never thought about it this way. Some things that you fix, like emotional issues, they can fix a problem in the physiology that corresponds to it. Like my ankles, for example, I still had a knee that was raging away and a wrist a couple of years ago. And yet my ankles that were the worst joints on my body, now I have no evidence there was ever anything wrong with them. I can't understand that there ever was. I can't even imagine it. And that was to do with an emotional issue that I managed to nip in the bud of being, you know, living in a house with my mum, who is kind of an interesting character, but she can be a bit disapproving, you know. And I was thinking, you get all these things in your head, the attitude towards it all. I've looked after her. She's in her 90s and whatever. And I'm trapped here. Any sort of trapped feeling that you might have in a job or whatever, you get rid of that, whether by reframing your attitude to it or just moving away. We moved away and I still take care of my mum. We get on much better than we ever did. We're actually addressing her breast cancer at the moment and getting a lump shrinking down by about a centimeter a month. We'll come to that in a while. That's kind of interesting. But when I moved out of that, suddenly the ankles healed within a week. Now, what happened there? It was extraordinary. It really was. And you can really see the connections. There are a lot of books that deal with that. Louise Hay's books have gone into that for decades now, since the 40s, 50s. And Inna Segal, she's done a book called The Secret Language of the Body. And it's extraordinary. You look in there and you look for some illness that you have in a particular part of the body, or even an accident to a particular part of the body, and you can relate it back to a stress in the emotions. And you know, 2 years I went just for diet, even though I've meditated and been a spiritual human being or whatever all my life. I still, when the shit hits the fan and you're really ill, you just go, oh, it can't be that. It's just diet. It's just, you know, you played on one.
Well, that's what's so cool about your story. And you know, I just want to touch back on something you said earlier about shopping for diagnoses. This is a huge thing. I mean, when people get brain fog or, I mean, whatever it is, whatever manifestation of kind of an immune response that people get, they jump on Google and they start Google doctoring their symptoms, and it can become so overwhelming. Everybody starts to think they have Lyme's disease. Everyone starts to think they have some sort of cancer, this or that. I mean, it becomes really daunting. So I think that's a really important thing. But it's kind of paradoxical at the same time, because for a lot of people, that's the beginning of their journey to changing everything about their life and rearranging their emotional, physical, spiritual bodies and lining up with a path that's more in line with something that will promote health on every level of their being. So, what do you think? Do you think it's more beneficial or more harmful that people are able to jump on the internet, talk to all these other people who are at the same healing crisis that they are and see you know, just this overwhelming amount of information that is available for these individuals. Well,
I don't know. You know, I went through a whole lot. I was lucky in that we had a bit of money at the time, and I could lie on the sofa and just research all this stuff. Because people say, well, how have you looked into all of this? Well, it was 12 hours a day, 3 years. You know, it was just constant researching and going down this rabbit hole and that one. And I didn't have to work. I couldn't have worked. I couldn't have done anything. So I was in a very lucky position there. And I think it can be dangerous. If you look for like 2 minutes, you're going to get paranoid, and you come first across the medical side. You see, I've got to keep qualifying this, because I seem to always be criticizing the medical people, and I'm not. I mean, the acute stuff, and I'm sure that eventually these things will dovetail in. The diagnosis is fantastic. If you go and get diagnosed, if you get diagnosed with an autoimmune condition, it's a long-term thing, well, then just walk away and do your own thing. But, you know, I can't say...
So that's a controversial statement. I mean, people are like, wow.
It is.
But what's the doctor really able to do? I mean, maybe we can get into your experiences. I mean, what did the doctors tell you? I mean, so people might say, oh, this guy's just cynical. He's a rebellious guy. He used to have dreadlocks. He plays drums. He was in bands. You know, he's just fucking the establishment.
I'm not mocking the establishment. I think they have great diagnostics. The science is fantastic. There's a use in everything, but I see the use in so many other things. You know, people either are into allopathic medicine and everything else is rubbish, or they're all the other way. I'm not like that at all. I just say, on my website, I did a blog post a while ago of how to get the best out of your doctor, because really you need to know what a doctor is actually capable of and what they're not capable of. And it's no disrespect to me to say they really are not capable of curing autoimmunity. They're not. It's just a fact. They're not doing it. They're knocking out some symptoms if they're lucky, but these chemicals have some very nasty side effects. There are some drugs out there that are very interesting, like low-dose naltrexone, which is pretty much harmless, and it's knocking out autoimmunity very, very safely.
I wanted to actually touch on your article there. You wrote this article, How to Get the Best Out of Your Doctor. And, you know, obviously, like you say in this article and in your book, seeing a doctor in certain circumstances is not bad. You know, I mean, you shouldn't avoid it in all cases.
Not at all.
You got a deep laceration. You got to go to a hospital. Antibiotics, these things are useful tools. Yes, they're overused, and they can do a lot of damage if used incorrectly, and if you don't take proper measures afterwards to kind of replenish the gut flora. But how can they optimize this relationship, and what are maybe some mistakes that you made along the way that can help people to optimize this situation?
Don't get angry with the docs. I did for a while. I saw them as really the devil, because they weren't doing me any good. They would just mock everything I was doing. Eventually, one of them saw what was going on, and he said, I want to keep an eye on you and present you to my colleagues, because he couldn't understand how I was still running around and I hadn't taken his drugs. I did take them, you know, only for about 6 weeks, though, and they got me in the worst mess I've ever been in. And I didn't even take the ones they really wanted me to take. But with the docs... I'm seeing a great difference now in them. I think a lot of them are starting to realize the real importance of gut flora. You know, things are coming up like fecal implants and things for knocking out IBS and Crohn's disease. And this is really going along the right track. It's marvelous medicine. The chemical-based thing, it, like you say, antibiotics, and everybody's demonizing them now because of the gut flora. If you have some horrendous bacterial disease or infection, it might be the only way that you're going to live. But then again, they don't really lead you through the fact that you need to rebuild the gut flora afterwards, because it's not something that they're taught. I had an interesting experience with a gastroenterologist a little while ago. My mother was, she's 92 now. She was getting some reflux when she was eating and whatever. And just to make sure it was nothing nasty, I took her along, and they wanted to put the camera down. And I thought, she's a bit frail for that. She won't like that. She's not happy with even swallowing a pill. So a big camera, I've had it, and it's not fun. So she took this barium swallow, and anyway, they looked and they said, no, there's nothing sinister. It's just a reflux thing. And I was sitting there talking to the gastroenterologist with her. And he was saying, yes, it's reflux and blah, blah. And I said, when I was diagnosed with that, I don't have any trouble with it anymore at all. I don't take anything. I explained to him roughly what I'd done with the keto thing, cutting out the inflammatory stuff, rebuilding the gut flora. And he was looking at me and I thought, any minute he's going to have a go at me, because quite often they do. They sort of sit there and then suddenly they say, yes, yes, well, of course, this is all nonsense. Now, here's the drugs. Anyway, my mum also doesn't take me that seriously. And she looked across at the doc and she said, so what are you going to do about it? And the doc looked across at her and said, nothing. Listen to your son. If you eat like that and you take the steps, he said, we won't need to do anything at all. If you know the gut, you know medicine. My jaw hit the floor. Her jaw hit the floor. I thought, wow. You know, I mean, it's so important that it's getting through to gastroenterologists, because like 6 years ago when I was in the same position, I had a camera down and they gave me all these drugs. They said nothing would work. Dietary, nothing will work. But now I think a lot of them are waking up. It's because that's one great thing. You asked about the internet and all this information. There is some lunatic stuff out of there. But if you start to really look, I'm sure you've seen it yourself, you start to see patterns coming up over and over again, and the wild things tend to fall away. Everybody's got a few wild things, and yet the core of it seems to be, for autoimmunity, this autoimmune protocol that everybody's quoting with the sort of pretty much almost a keto diet, really low starches, no sugars, no nightshades, no pulses, no grains, and rebuild the gut flora. It seems to be a common thread that's running through, even if it's slightly different. Somebody's got a slightly different take on it.
I mean, even if you have the raw vegan approach, right? You mentioned in the beginning, like, that was the first step that you took. Now, I mean, there's so many steps in your journey that I think are fascinating. We could do a 5-hour podcast, and we're gonna have to have you on again. Because it can be hard to know what to prioritize in the conversation. But you mentioned the raw food diet. I mean, that, for the most part, these people are, they're utilizing things like juice fasts, where very low sugar juices, a lot of times people will be doing green juice fasting, to where they're probably on the outskirts or full-blown ketosis most of the time anyways on these raw food diets. I mean, it's a highly anti-inflammatory diet. But I don't know, it's really interesting the way that people take things to extremes. So it's like, and you even mentioned this in your book, if vegetarian is good, raw veganism is going to be exponentially better. If lowering my carbohydrates are good, then cutting them out completely and only eating meat is going to be better. And there's always going to be people on the extremes testing these things. And it's interesting, it kind of brings us to this synthesis, whereas you can take aspects that the raw food people are using of celebrating fresh, organic, local foods, lots of vegetables, lots of greens, and combine it with something like what the paleo people are doing, is utilizing fat as a fuel instead of carbohydrates. And then you have this synthesis in the middle where people are like, okay, look, there's natural interventions, dietary interventions, and allopathic medicine has its place. And we're kind of seeing this synthesis. So I think, yeah, the extremes on both ends, although people love to rag on them and all this so crazy, those are what bring progress and bring a synthesis of knowledge to that like spearhead of where healing and medicine are actually going.
I think that a lot of people are chasing down the ideal diet when they get ill. The first thing they do is, what should I eat? Is this good for me? Is this bad for me? And it's not really a question of that. It's, I think that a lot of Jack Cruz's stuff that he's brought up, that it depends where you are on the planet. You know, other people have brought this up before. He's not the first one. Right. But he was the one who brought my attention to it, that the higher the sunlight, and the vitamin D available, the more carbs grow. Is an Inuit going to do well on a diet of bananas? Probably not. But they, in keto, they've got their high fat, they've got their fish, and they've got their occasional caribou meat or whatever they have. So They're fine up there, and yet down on the equator they're eating something very different because they've got a load more vitamin D or whatever it is. You see, the light cycles, all of these theories, but I don't know if we pieced it all together yet. We probably haven't pieced a thousandth of it together.
Approaching the surface and testing what
But it's a matter, for me, it's a matter of trusting the planet, because we can't eat like Paleolithic man did. Of course we can't, but I find that if we eat local stuff, that's grown in season. It's probably what the planet intends us to eat at that time, at our latitude and locality. Yeah. So I can't, that seems to work the best for me. So when people say that, I'm saying this is good or that's bad, or I'm not really, because I don't know. I really don't know. All I can do is say that if you're autoimmune, going towards keto, at least for some considerable time, will help. But keto, of course, isn't necessary for everybody. But it, depending on where you are on the planet, we have so much disconnect. This is around here. I'm in the north of England, and just north of us is Scotland, and that's known as the MS belt, isn't it? It's just where everybody gets so much MS. And why is that? It's, you're not up in the cold where you're really freezing and cold adapted. You're not down near the equator where you've got your top off and you're getting the vitamin D all the time. You're in this middle doldrums place where it's all gray and raining outside. Nobody wants to go out and connect with the planet when it's like that. So they're staying inside with the heating, the Wi-Fi, the all of this dirty electricity, the blue light constantly, all of these things are so important. And that's what kicks things off. So you've got to cover all these bases. And with food, there is no clear delineation of what's great, what isn't. The raw vegan thing, I mean, I don't even understand the thing of detox. I was one big thing, great thing that this did for me, which was why it was the best thing that ever happened to me as well, is that it throws out all of your preconceptions. We have these preconceptions, these brainwashings that we give to ourselves from growing up, say, in the south of England, in a sort of middle-class society that I did, then into the hippie society, and then into the meditation spiritual society. And you get certain beliefs about things. Like, I thought, okay, even though I'd been eating meat and my body craved meat, I had to go raw vegan because that was the good, sort of heartfelt, good, holy thing to do, if you like.
What year was this? What year was it that you started doing the raw vegan thing? I'm curious.
About 2011, beginning of 2011, and by that time, I wasn't even eating vegetarian before that. You know, I'd added chicken in and stuff like that, but I was still eating a load of wheat and dairy. I'd have pasta with cheese and then a whole tub of Haagen-Dazs afterwards. You know, and it's no wonder it all went wrong. And that was
an interesting common thread of like a lot of these diets that people utilize at work. You know, at least for a certain amount of time, I think the raw vegan thing can be a really good. And there's a lot that people can learn from it. Everybody likes to bash it because it sounds so extreme. It's eliminating all these foods, eliminating meat, and you know, where you're going to get your vitamin K from, where you're going to get your, you know, your vitamin D. You have the paleo versus the raw vegan. They're actually so, so similar. But the common thread between all these is eliminating certain processed foods, foods that were likely newly introduced into our diet that need a lot of refining, and that are just highly inflammatory and create a huge blood sugar response. And, you know, I mean, I don't think these foods are bad all the way across the board for everybody, but it's a common thread of people carrying autoimmune disease that they usually end up eliminating these foods. And that's kind of the first thing. And then it doesn't completely cure it. And then they start taking into consideration other lifestyle things like getting adequate sunlight, possibly completely changing their environment, moving somewhere where there's less, you know, non-native electromagnetic fields. For a lot of people, that makes a huge difference. And you know, maybe starting on some sort of a spiritual practice, some meditation, or something like that. So maybe we can jump into a little bit of. See, this is kind of what I see as the meat and potatoes of your book, or the meat and the meat and coconut oil if you're in the keto. Is the spiritual aspects of healing, and you kind of mention overtly as well as hint at this importance of submission. And it seems like kind of across the board for a lot of people when they want to heal, a lot of it comes down to maybe to a submission to a greater force than themselves. Submission to, first of all, it might be submission to, okay, I'm dealing with this autoimmune disease and this is probably something that I have brought upon myself, or through my actions, or through the actions of my ancestors, whatever it is, this is manifested. I've got to deal with it. And then in the healing process, there usually seems to be kind of a, you know, submission to a higher power, and that becomes very, very important to a lot of people. So, you used to be really into meditation, and then it seems like your relationship with that maybe changed a little bit once you when you had your healing crisis. So What are the aspects, what are the important aspects of healing on an emotional, mental, and what I would kind of call spiritual level? And how did you deal with that? And how did that evolve over the time of your discovery of healing crisis?
It's really simple. It can be answered in one sentence of just not loving what is, you know? It's easy for us to love what is when everything's rosy, everything's great. But actually, if we can also love what is when things go wrong, we expect that everything has to be perfect in life. Everything has to tick along every day and we need to be happy and all of this sort of thing. Whereas imagine seeing a film where somebody gets up in the morning and then they have breakfast and then they go to work and everything's nice. Then they come home and then they sit and watch some telly and then they go to bed. You're not going to sell that script. Stuff's got to go wrong. Things have got to blow up. People have got to hit other people. You know, things have got to go wrong. It doesn't matter if these things go wrong. It's like when I hear somebody with cancer and they say, I'm fighting it. I think you're in trouble. You know, surrender to it and find out what it is that it's trying to tell you. And very often cancer goes in a couple of weeks. You know, it's a very quick thing when it turns around. I think it's all a matter. It is all a matter of loving what is. It sounds really corny. So what is that? What does it mean exactly? It means just, it's a guy called Jeff Foster, sort of non-dual teacher, said a lovely thing one day. He said, accept everything, love everything as it is. And if you really find that you can't love what is, love that too. And that's great, because you're never going to absolutely love everything that's going on. But just to absolutely accept, I'm ill, this is what's happening, let's not fight, let's not have this, I hate this thing, oh, look at my knee, it's all swollen, oh, look at this, just go, okay, look, this has happened, this is a part of life, this is cool, and let's relax into this and start to really investigate. Start to just ask your own subconscious what it is that it's trying to tell you. There are ways to do this. I would say a very, very good ways are EFT, emotional freedom technique, Byron Katie's The Work. You know, these are all easily find. You can easily find these things online. Meditation, yeah, it's wonderful. The thing about meditation and why it seems that I changed my relationship with it is that meditation, most of the time people use meditation, if it's used as a relaxation technique, I mean, it's incredibly beneficial. It has all sorts of wonderful effects on the physiology. But what you find when something goes really wrong is very often it hasn't equipped you for that, because it equips you for being very good at being a meditator and very good at sitting down and attaining tremendous states of bliss and having extraordinary experiences. But what all meditate, well, no, I don't know about all meditators, but ones who sort of consider themselves very serious yogis or whatever are doing is they're doing this to gain enlightenment, if you like. They want to find this perfect state where everything's hunky-dory, nothing matters anymore, everything's bliss, you love everybody, and you know, all of that sort of thing. You know everything, you're all these things. Well, I think there's a whole load of misconceptions about that. That get people running along, you know, with a carrot on a stick, and it's strapped onto their head, and they'll never quite get to it. They're chasing and chasing, like trying to bite a beach ball or something, and it's running away from you all the time. You can never quite get to that, because how can anything that's absolute truth be anything that wasn't there all the time? It's the base of life. It's the canvas that life's painted on. And if we stop panicking about things that are going on and just allow them to be, and then take it back to the root of where these experiences come from and who you are, the root of who you are as a being, all of these things come to the same place, which is just this unmanifest field, if you like, that all these experiences are projected on, the cinema screen of life. Once you've seen it, you don't need to stare at it all the time. You can enjoy the film again, but once you know that everything is a bit of a game, it's a film, things come round, nothing's permanent, you're ill now, you're in pain, it's never going to be like that the whole time, it's never not going to be like that the rest of your life. It's going to change, might get worse, might get better, will change, you know. But these things morph around and they change. That's just what life's about. So to find out what is actually behind all of this, and essentially to see that we're not really separate entities. We're not separate entities. We are, and this is where I guess people are watching and going, what the hell's he on about? But, you know, we are part of a whole organism. Everything is part of a whole organism. Whatever's happening is perfect. You go back to the diet thing, raw veganism, great. Okay, I might advise somebody who has autoimmunity, it's perhaps not the way to go. But look, whatever they're doing, whatever anybody's doing or eating is perfect at the time. You don't need to worry about it. People come to me now, particularly since that Buddha at the gas pump thing, and want to Skype me about autoimmunity and maybe some of this non-dual business. And it's a great pleasure to chat to them. It's lovely. But, you know, there's no right and wrong anymore. I don't see that there's any, whatever anybody's doing is right or wrong. When I look at all the awful things that I did to my own body that got me to that stage of such pain and being so ill, because it was the best thing that happened, I can't really even criticize eating a load of wheat and pizza and Haagen-Dazs and, you know, and getting stuck into a vegetarian rice and dal diet for so many years. I have no problem with it, because we can't judge. Often the things that we think are bad come with the best things afterwards, the silver lining. So it's recognizing the silver lining and having faith that well, not faith, because faith implies doubt. It's getting to a point of knowing what is your essential nature. Because once you realize that, there is no real problem. The pain, the happiness, unhappiness, all of these things are very small compared to really being in a place where you totally accept yourself, whether you have a horrendous disease, whether you've just won the lottery, you know, whatever it is that's happened to you is really so inconsequential because you've really seen that. And after all those years of meditating, the thing that pushed me into that was being that ill. And it was kind of letting go of stuff, surrendering on all levels. You let go of the stuff in your diet that's causing you harm. You let go of the emotions that are causing you harm. And then eventually you just get left with who you actually are. And it's quite a surprise, because it's not bells and whistles. It's not huge fireworks going off and some great big thing that you discover. It's just... And then people, if you talk about it, people don't like it either. You know, talking about the fact that you've had some big shift in consciousness, it seems to be almost frowned on now. Like,
well, it doesn't make sense unless somebody else. The funny thing is, it doesn't resonate, it doesn't make sense, and it sounds stupid to anyone who's yes. experienced the same exact thing. So somebody who's experienced the same thing, then it's like, okay, shut up about it. I know what you're saying, and it's unsayable. And then to somebody who's never experienced it, it's like, oh man, like, is this guy like stoned or something? Like, what is this guy talking about? You know, it's like, shut up, hippie. Yeah. But you know, what I really like, and I think you mentioned this in that, the Buddha and the gas tank thing, because I think we have to define things like meditation. You have to define what these things are. And there's so many different schools of meditation. And I think a lot of what people get really into this meditation, into this like letting go. And then it becomes this game of chasing this fake non-dual state where you're kind of just zone the hell out and not really doing anything. And then you come back to the world and you've still got this like dualistic world. Like, you have to take a shit, wipe your ass. You have like, you have this and that. You got the mailman coming, giving you an eviction notice. And then it's like, I freak out. It's like, why am I not enlightened yet? I got to go back and meditate. You know, you go back into this dark room, close the door, umbity, 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 and it's like, it's like this thing of trying to escape the present. But where something that you mentioned before and that I've noticed as well in life is like, meditation shouldn't be about escaping the present. It should be about equipping yourself to properly and calmly apply your will within the present, to let go what you need to let go of, and to actually function within this world of duality that everybody wants to seem to escape from. But then as soon as they're out of it, they get so happy to come back into it anyways. It's a funny thing. I mean, life is full of these paradoxes.
Paradox is beautiful. It's the acceptance of paradox, isn't it? There's nothing wrong with paradox. I mean, everything's fine. When you can come out of meditation, then you realize that the wiping your ass and the mailman coming around with the summons or whatever, all of this stuff is it as well. There is no outside to that field of consciousness or whatever it is, God or whatever it is that people call it. there is no outside of that. You know, everything is in that. It's not something you find with your eyes shut that's outside you or even inside you. It's just everything, and you're part of everything. When you have this permanent sort of awareness that you're just a wave on the surface of the ocean, if you like, it breaks, it comes up, it goes down, you know, a life comes and goes, but it's all part of the ocean. And when we're so disconnected, I think there's something in the Vedas that says all suffering is born of duality. And it's just kicking against what's happening. It is. It's all down to kicking against what's happening. If you can surrender to whatever that's going on, you find that most of the demons just weren't there anyway. They were all of your making. Have you heard of a guy? Oh God, he died recently. What is his name? Lovely guy. Anyway, one of the great authors on all of this. His name will come to me. Wayne Dyer. There we go. Wayne Dyer. And he tells a story about going to his publisher, I think, who was dying, and he said to him, Wayne, my life has been full of many terrifying and traumatic events, most of which never happened. It's a lovely way of putting it, because we just, most of this stuff we just dream up, we really do. It isn't as bad as you think. It's absolutely fine. And once you can surrender, it's very difficult. I went through, it's not something that you can switch on. It isn't. It's, I went through a couple of years of really wrestling with this, you know, reading book after book, looking at video after video, thinking, how has this happened? Just before I got really ill, maybe 3-4 years before I got really ill, I did have a really big glimpse of this that kind of stuck. And I spent 4 years in a tremendously good state. And then this hit, and it was, this is why I've listened to so many of those Buddha at the Gas Pump things, because so many people have terrible troubles after any kind of a glimpse into the absolute, if you like. Mm-hmm. It can bring all the shit to your doorstep at once. But that's cool, you know? And it is, it's a horrific experience. But when you do really surrender and see that it's okay and stuff comes out the other side, as long as you allow it, as long as you allow this guy in, it's like, you know, the tax man's banging at the door or whatever. You can leave him out there for ages, he's going to bang and bang. But eventually you just say, okay, come in, let's sort this out. You sort it out and out he goes.
Yeah.
And this is what it's like with disease.
Yeah.
You take it on all levels and surrender to every level of it and then start subtracting and subtracting and subtracting. You see, modern medicine is so much about adding. That's why I think that the allopathic thing is great for diagnosis, but then walk away and start subtracting.
You're mentioning submitting to every single level of it. Now, I'm not. This could sound like nitpicking, but in my experience of dealing with difficult situations in my own life and seeing other people, you know, dealing with suffering in their life in different ways, whether it's physical or spiritual, the submission is huge. The submission to, but it's not so much a submission to the autoimmune condition and to the diagnosis of I'm screwed. I think a lot of people, that's the problem with a lot of people, is they submit to this thing of like, oh, there's nothing I can do about it except go into despair, take a bunch of drugs, tell everybody about my great suffering and hope that maybe I'll just, you know, somehow get through this. The submission is more like a submission to, like you said, this greater force of what is. And the fact that you mentioned the word faith, and I think faith's a really good word. To me, it comes down to submission to reality, to submission to like, okay, the tax man's knocking at the door. And I can't just sit here and ignore it because it's going to get louder and louder. And eventually, like, if you're in America, they're going to knock down your door with guns and tell you, stop resisting and shoot you in the face. And tase you a few times before, maybe. Or just shoot your dog if you're lucky. but that tax man's going to come through the door regardless. So you got to submit to that. And then there comes a point where you've got to exert your will and make choices and say, okay, this is something that can be dealt with. Yes, submission is an important thing. Submitting to that greater will, that greater authority that is much bigger than all of us, that is outside of this little petty realm that we inhabit, that, you know, a greater power. I mean, you mentioned God, and that's a word, that's one of my favorite words that I very rarely use because it's so loaded with so many people. You know, I mean, say it, they automatically tune out. Oh, it's like, you know, everybody's got their own little thing with that. So, but to me, it really does come down to that submission to that greater power and connection with the wisdom behind it. And okay, this is not, I'm not meant to be here suffering forever. This is a reminder that I got to get in line and that there's something wrong in this situation that can be corrected. And if I
exactly. do, that's really important. That's really important because, you see, when you go and get diagnosed, so you go into a rheumatologist and he says, right, you've got inflammatory arthritis, your joints will never be the same again, dietary interventions won't work, and all that works is our pills. I mean, imagine how long it takes to unwind that, because these are the experts. These are the big experts in front of you. Now, I can see, and I had so many doubts for so long, the first year and a half or so I had doubts, but I thought, I'm going to do it or I'm going to die. I'm just going to make sure I get this sorted. But now you could just relax from the very start, because imagine instead you walk into a rheumatologist and they go, oh, I'm sorry to see that. But listen, you've done it to yourself. Now, if we take some dietary interventions, we're going to be able to calm this down. And then we're going to send you to some other departments where you're going to learn about balancing emotions and stuff. Just really don't worry about this, because you're going to come out of this better than you went in.
Yeah, it's and worrying about it more is going to make it worse. Yeah. Just so you know, yeah. straight off the bat, the more yeah. you worry about it, the worse your digestion's going to be. The more you're going to hate everything around you. The more you're going to kick and scream and fight against the process that you should be embracing.
Yes. yeah. I love it when I Skype with people, and the first thing I say, they come on, they go, oh, "I've got this arthritis or something, I've got this," and I'm saying, "Listen, I know it's a bad, but I'm excited for you. This is going to be a great journey." You know, you've no idea how quickly it can go. It's at the start, you're going to have some big revelations. You're going to discover some amazing things. Yes, you can get out of it. I was like that. Look, I'm fine now. I'm playing drums all the time. I'm training with weights again, riding mountain bikes. I'm okay. And I don't take any drugs. And this is what you can do. And you see them beaming. You see their whole spirits lifted, you know, because someone's actually told them. Because they don't, it's like my friends. So half of them think I'm an idiot. Half of them think I just had a bad knee, you know. You know what it's like in your hometown. But you see, I'm to them, I'm some great expert on there. And I'm saying, listen, I've done this. And well, I am actually, because I have done it and I found ways through it. I don't ever say that my way is the only way or the best way, because I don't know. I've made so many journeys of discovery and had to throw out so many ideas that I really don't know. And if I write about this stuff, it might sound arrogant sometimes, but it's not. It's just the best I've discovered. If somebody comes along to me and tells me that doing 10 somersaults a day in custard is going to get rid of it, and it does, I'm happy to throw out the whole keto thing, you know? I'll take anything on board. But this is the best I've found. I've on a big plateau phase of not having found anything better out there when I do. But it's lovely to see people. You just introduce them to their disease, if you like that, by saying, hey, this is exciting. Okay, your life's going to change, but my God, you're going to come out of this better. You see how they brighten up even to start with.
Well, you're instilling that hope in them. You're giving them You're giving them that faith that you exude, because you know it's like, look, you can do this. This is, everything's okay. First of all, you're going to be all right. Yeah, there's some things that went wrong, but you can right those wrongs and you can get back on track and at least have a better life than you thought you'd be able to have when you were diagnosed and told that there was nothing you could do about it.
Absolutely. Awesome. And it takes a while for that to sink in. And I just wish they were doing that. You know, I just wish that the medical profession at some point would start to do that.
The problem kind of becomes too, that it can be overwhelming to a lot of people, because when they realize, oh, there's not just a magic bullet. I can't just stop eating Ben and Jerry's and wheat and expect my whole life to feel better, me to be a better husband and father, correct the bitterness I had towards my father and my mother. You know, like, you can't just expect this. It's like, oh, wow, so I got to deal with that? Oh, I've got to look, like, deep into myself and all those parts that I try and run away from, hide away from, and pretend they're not there, even though they're like, right in everybody's face all the time and they can all see. Oh, no. So, yeah.
No, it's difficult. Yeah, they're not going to be – it's going to give – you see, the people I see are generally the people who've been through the medical thing and they've been told all that stuff. Obviously, on the first day, that's going to be difficult because people do just want the magic bullet then. But you can lead them through that. You know, after a while, you can introduce that stuff. You can say that to them to start with, and then they go away and they will have their panic. Of course they'll have their panic. Oh, my God, I've got an incurable disease. that will happen. But God, if you look at it now, so many people are reversing these things. So many people are shedding, you know, cancers really quickly. I've shown it with my mum. You know, I guess I can talk about this now a bit. I didn't really plan on it, but she's 92. She said to me, I've got a lump in my breast. She's ignored it probably for 7-8 years. You know, it's big. And I'm actually glad, because back that time ago, they probably have killed her with something by now.
Yeah.
Because they killed my dad, without a doubt. You know, their intentions were great. I don't blame them or anything, but the medicines that he was given were totally unnecessary and blew his heart up. And, you know, he had a brain tumor. He died in 2003, 77 years old. Now, my mum's was a bit older than him, and we thought she'd be gone way before him. And when he died, I looked at her medicine. She was on so many meds, and I didn't really know much about it at the time. But I threw them all away. And the doc said, oh, you can't do that. I said, well, look, she's real ill, and I want to just try it a different way. I just took away the meds, took her down to a chiropractor. She was in a wheelchair with so much sciatica and whatever. And now, she was 80 then, 79, 80. Now she's 92. She's running around. She picks up my daughter, and you saw my daughter who's 7. She picks her up and runs around her flat. I mean, she's fine. Okay.
What serendipity that she ignored it for 7 years, but seven years ago, that's when you were diagnosed and when you started your journey of learning how to help deal with these things. And then now you're here.
Well,
and you
could she noticed it, because we wouldn't give her, we wouldn't send her for mammograms or anything. I think that's a pretty of a dodgy thing that pumps too much radiation and probably triggers a few things off, but there's a controversial subject there.
Right. Right.
I, you know, we went to the oncologist, and he said, yeah, okay, it's breast cancer. We wouldn't go for chemo or radiotherapy, but we go for these hormonal something or others, you know, that, because it might be hormone driven. I said, well, I don't know about that. Let me go and research into it. And I went and had a look, and I found forums full of people saying there was very bad joint pains, that lots of nausea. I found it had been banned in India. And I thought, let's have a go at this naturally. And so I said, it's not going to do anything to her in the next little while. Lump in the breast.
She's 92, right? I mean, 92 years old. You don't want to do too hardcore of an intervention with chemo.
No, exactly.
Because the immune system's so weak, so frail.
Yeah. So we piled a bunch of things in. We a lot of the stuff I kind of knew already from the my research is into autoimmunity. But have you seen these videos, The Truth About Cancer? Absolutely wonderful. This guy Ty Bollinger's done them, and my God, I mean, he's got oncologists up there talking about the real truth of it. He goes to various clinics in the world where they're really wiping out cancer, like in Lithuania, is it? They got the Rigvir virus that they've engineered, and they bung that in, and it's just eating cancer.
Oh, wow.
You know, and then they've got some, you know, medicine has some extraordinary advances, but it's all on the fringes of it.
Yeah.
The mainstream cancer business, $280 billion a year, it's huge, and it's you know, it is a chemo. Yeah. Anyway, so we decided, we looked at this and we got a load of tips from it. SEAC team, we got all the cordyceps, reishi and chaga and whatever into her, and, mm-hmm. and apricot kernels, and got her into keto.
Doing interventions to boost her immune system, and you changed her diet.
Yeah. And we showed her these videos. So from the start, it was not, oh, you've got cancer, this is awful. And I was kind of ready to keep her away from the oncologist if they started saying that. And it was just, hey, Ma, look at this journey you're going on. She was jumping up and down, excited. It's like, whoa, we're going to do this, aren't we? I don't want anything to do with the kids. She saw some people being wheeled around in wheelchairs really close to death, you know, in that clinic. Right. And she was going, just get me out of here. You know, I don't want anything to do with that.
So how is she doing now? I mean, how long have you guys been doing these interventions?
About 4 months. And the lump is shrinking down.
Yeah. How much is it shrunk?
It's shrunk down from about, we've got about 2 centimeters down now. It's slowed down this month. It's only gone about 3 millimeters, but last month it went down a whole centimeter. I think maybe, I don't know anything, I'm no oncologist, but maybe would it be denser in the middle where maybe it started and then grew out? I don't know how these things grow.
Right.
Who knows? But healing paths are never straight, are they? They're always up and down. And they go. But I've never seen her healthier. She's happy. She's in a tremendous frame of mind. I have got her some low dose naltrexone too, because that is said to do. I've just taken this blunderbuss effect, you know, blunderbuss sort of approach to it, and And she's real happy and it seems to be fine. I don't know, we got an appointment in February. We'll see how it goes. But I'm quietly confident, but I see cases of people doing it. I see more people with autoimmunity and diabetes and whatever who are reversing it personally. But I don't have much to do with people with cancer. I mean, it kind of scared me because we all have this thing about the big C. Oh my God. But if you look at it and you hear it, Anita Morjani talking, have you heard her? This extraordinary lady, this Indian lady, she was very, very close to death. She had tumors everywhere. They were coming through the skin. They were everything. And she was, you know, they gathered all the relatives. She was gone, really. She was absolutely gone. She was in a coma. But she was aware of everything going on, and she had this real awakening experience. And then while she was kind of out of the body and decided to come back in, and 2 weeks later, the cancer was gone. Her story is amazing. She does a great one with Rick, actually, on Buddha at the Gas Pump, where he asks some of the deeper questions that most people don't ask in her interviews. But she made an interesting point. She said, Rick said to her, what do you think is the main problem that's causing this epidemic of cancer? And she said, fear of cancer. And it is, it's always this, right, get checked for this. This will do this to you. This is carcinogenic. This is, you know, oh, I've got a little lump. Oh, it must be a tumor.
I think it's so weird when you look at kind of the online health community and whatnot, health community. I mean, it's, you see a lot of people kind of poo-pooing anybody who wants to go a non-traditional route. Oh, this is dangerous. These people are promoting these unproven things, and you know, they're denying their children this important chemotherapy and stuff like that. And yeah, you know, there's a lot of interesting ethical arguments from both sides, but I'm completely supportive of anybody being able to treat their body as if it is their own property, and experiment on their body. And if they don't want to go through the traditional cancer treatment, I mean, when I look at traditional cancer treatment, it just looks, I mean, a lot of it just looks like an assembly line of death. And this isn't true all the way across the board. Of course, some people get cured and it works for some people.
I didn't understand exactly what was going on until I had a look at this series of videos. Are beautiful, very informative. Mm-hmm. But I understood that chemo, finally, I hadn't had a reason to look at it, but you see that it attacks the cancer cells and the healthy cells, but it doesn't really have any effect on the stem cells, which is where the cancers come from. So that's the one area that you should be sorting out, the body's ability to produce healthy stem cells.
Fasting actually does affect the ability.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I mean, so many people are knocking out these cancers by doing 40-day fasts, aren't they? Sort of 40-day water fasts.
I mean, you have the Gerson thing that's been working for quite a bit of people, the Hippocrates Institute. And that was a plant-based approach. I mean, there are many different ways that people can go about. I wouldn't say that like juice fasting inevitably is going to be sustainable. But as far as, you know, an intervention, fasting seems to be probably more effective than some of these other things. And of course, I'm not saying that's what people should all do, but be open.
No, me neither. Do whatever you do.
Yeah.
But I would say if anybody is watching this and they do have cancer, I would say absolutely have a look at thetruthaboutcancer.com. Have a look at that series of videos, because there are some very, very knowledgeable people on there, both from the allopathic side and from alternative clinics, who are having tremendous results. And some of them are staggering. I mean, I was really close to tears some of the time watching these success stories of people who are in terrible trouble, and now they're completely cancer-free. Because often, even if they kill the tumor with chemo, it comes back more aggressively 3 years, 5 years later, because they've knocked out the immune system. But to have a look at what these guys are doing, don't do anything that I've done or I'm saying here. Go make up your own mind, you know, talk to your oncologist, but have a look at these guys now, because he's got some cutting-edge people on there. Very important videos, I think, there. Cool guy.
But anyway. That's what's important, is making up your own mind, being able to explore these with an open mind, and not just, oh, well, this guy's an expert and he says that this is the truth, so that's what I believe. I'm going to say what he says. I've got four questions that I kind of that came to mind just reading the introduction of your book. I thought were really important to the nature of our conversation and the nature of kind of what you're saying in your book. The first one is, does health equal fitness?
It depends what people have this idea of fitness to do with some athletic ability, don't they? I mean, fitness for me is fitness for life. You're as fit and as healthy as you need to be for whatever it is that you do. You
so yeah, you turn it around. Yeah, you assuming yeah. that fitness means like physically fit, but real fitness is the ability to deal with, you know, adversity, to deal with harsh, you know, to deal with reality. So
yeah. Absolutely. Right. Exactly. Yeah. It's
how to that question on a higher level. So good job. What about this? Does health equal happiness?
It can be a significant, yes, it can be a significant part of it. But what I'd say, which I think is really important, is regaining of health can be a lot better towards to happiness than just the actual maintaining of health. You know, if you regain your health from something like this, it can be it's a huge boost. I mean, you no longer feel reliant on other people. You no longer feel, oh, something's going to go wrong at some point. I'm going to need a doctor or whatever. So health, yes, it's. I think that's just a matter of valuing it. People who've been really healthy don't generally value it so much. But if you've lost it and then regained it, it can be a tremendous, oh yes, I would say I'm happier than I've ever been before.
It's like you don't know what you have till it's gone.
Yes, exactly. And then you manage to regain it. Oh, then you really, yes. Gratitude is an enormous thing, you know, and I never really was. I'd moan about stuff or I'd quite enjoy it, but I was never really grateful for anything. And now I am just, you know, every moment. I don't walk up and down a set of stairs now without being so grateful, because I remember times when I couldn't, you know. It's marvelous to just do stairs two at a time now. Right. And I couldn't even do them one at a time for a while. And it's a lovely feeling. But gratitude, there's that great expression, isn't there? Just imagine that you will only wake up tomorrow with the stuff that you were grateful for today. Mm. It's cool.
So maybe happiness, I mean, if we want to really properly define happiness, I don't know, gratitude might be a better word for what real happiness is, because happiness, you know, you can load it up. Like, there's things that people would say make them happy that are kind of just negative cycles if you look at it later on in life, or if other people were to look at it and put a value judgment on it. So.
Well, Eckhart Tolle said something about in his Power of Now, which is a wonderful series of books and audio tapes. I've got them, so I don't know how many books they are, audio recordings. But he said something about illness, and he was saying, well, when you're ill, you may not be happy, you may suffer, but if you really do surrender to the present and find that ground of all being and find that sort of peace, if you like, happiness becomes a very inconsequential thing. So it doesn't knock our equilibrium when it disappears, because we have something so much bigger. You know, you get a motorbike and then you wonder why you're ever interested in that football when you were 7 years old or something. You know, the motorbike's far more interesting now. And that's it. You know, if you can find that real source of life, that center of peace and abundance, you've got everything, really. And then the suffering, if it comes and goes, hard financial times, problems, losing friends, whatever it is, it doesn't touch you anywhere near so much.
Yeah. And there's a paradox again to those, because a lot of people, you know, me included, don't really properly connect with that until they've experienced the other aspect of suffering, of kicking and screaming and fighting against it and crying and whining that it's not perfect and it's not how I wanted it, or it's not, you know, it's not good enough for me. Wham, wham, wham. It's hard to define that without dealing with that too. So there's the paradox of life.
It's all paradox. The more I go on, the more I realize that I don't really know what's going on.
Yeah. I mean, anything worth thinking about usually resides at the end in some sort of a paradox that makes us say, oh, wow, that's just pretty amazing experience life. It's a healing. I mean, your healing that you've experienced and that you've seen in other people in your life, how would you define healing?
That's a great question, isn't it? How would you define healing? Most people define healing as the cessation of pain and disease. But for me, healing is coming closer to who you are in your essential nature. And as the more you do that, the more things tend to clear up in its wake. We put the cart before the horse an awful lot in healing. We panic so much about physical symptoms, and I did as well. And I know that most of my life has been spent really interested in all of this spiritual stuff, yogi stuff, you know, Carlos Castaneda stuff from when I was very young. All of this stuff I've been obsessed with all my life. And yet when I got really ill, I was just interested in the physical symptoms. So I know it's going to be really, really difficult for somebody who's coming from a standing start, just had a job, you know, and then now their job's gone because they're disabled from some autoimmune condition. They haven't had a spiritual background as such. It's going to be difficult for them to accept that that's a part of healing, and that it is. A lot of times doctors sort of palm stuff off, say, oh, it's all in your head. Or we have something where it goes, oh, this kind of worked, it was just a placebo effect. But the placebo effect is what they should be studying, you know? This is the real healer, isn't it? I mean, there is a book now, isn't there, The Placebo Effect? But that, to me, says, oh, that's fantastic. If somebody says, oh, there was a placebo effect on there, I go, well, aren't you cool? You've got the ability to heal yourself there.
Wow, the placebo effect is more powerful than most approved drugs.
Exactly. So why are they researching the drugs? It's the placebo effect they need to look at. Right. And if you start them off with that tremendous positivity, say healing is completely possible. It's up to you and your own journey, how fast you go on that path. But healing's totally possible. But you have to pretty much look at something ahead of the healing. If you're always panicking about the physical healing, you have to let that go at some point. And you have to go to... There are ways, that's why I did the book, the first part being the diagnosis and the horror, the second part, taming of the beast, what you can do to get those symptoms down to a point where they're not all consuming. And then the third part, what it is to find the real healing, to go beyond that into the realm of the emotions and the more spiritual aspects. And it's very difficult to get across in a short interview, but it's something that you can lead people down various rabbit holes. My website, the Pure Activity, and the subline there is developing your intuition so you don't need this anymore. Because there's nothing I would dislike more than somebody thinking that I'd cured them or something. Right. It's putting it in their hands to use their own intuition. And so many people who I've helped out, they come back with so many great ideas. You know, and when I think I've got some fixed idea, somebody will blow it out. My son, he's 26. He knows far more about Jack Cruz's stuff than I do. He wrote a letter to his endocrinologist that even his endocrinologist didn't understand. You know, he's really delved into it. He's got an incredible mind about how stuff works. And yet he had such trouble on keto. It made him really ill. He couldn't deal with it. And because he had this hyperglycemia issue. And when you throw that in, it can be a real problem in low carb. And it's all sorts of different fixes to get around it. And I don't really understand that side of things. If anybody comes to me with that, I kind of put him on. Somebody Skyped me the other day. I said, hey, Tom, come and talk to this guy because he knows much more about that side of it. And he's changed my ideas on it as well. You know, I just thought at the beginning, I thought, right, everybody just go keto and everything's going to be great. Well, yes, in a lot of respects.
It's not smooth for everybody. No,
it's not. It's not. It's me. It can be interesting. It can be all kinds.
Like when you first get a hold of some tools, it's like you want to just, like, everything looks where they say everything looks like a nail when you're holding a hammer, right?
So
once you get those stubborn nails and you're like, oh, wow, you can't put your nail through a brick or it cracks the brick. So I got to pick something else out. But it's an interesting thing.
Yeah, so it's healing physical. Now it's on every level. It has to be on every level because we're on every level. Things come, everything comes from the subtle to the gross. Just as simple as building a skyscraper. Somebody has the idea and then they put the plans together and then they built it. This is what happens.
Where does the idea come from? You know, where does,
Yeah, that's it. It comes from the whole cosmic computer, doesn't it?
I think that this definition that you gave about healing is just absolutely, perfect, you know, coming in to lining up with what you really are. And that sounds like, I mean, to a lot of people, that's like, oh, that sounds so silly. That makes no sense.
It's a difficult one. It's such a difficult one to get hold of. When you're really ill, you know, that's why I wrote the book into three sections. If you just jump in with that, people are going to think you're nuts.
Yeah.
And I can see even with publishers, people think I'm nuts. because they don't want to be dealing with that. They've got, oh, we've got books on autoimmunity written by doctors, and they've gone into the low-carb diet, and they've gone, and that's what we want, you know. But don't make me write that book. Don't make me write that one, because the book that I really wanted to read when I was ill is the one that I've just written. I'm a Buddha at the Gas Pump addict. I listen to them all. I just put them on podcast and put them in headphones and listen to them. But as soon as somebody starts teaching or actually talking about it, I switch off. But what I love is the stories about how people have broken through. And a lot of other people go, oh, we don't want these stories. It's irrelevant. Their personal situation is irrelevant. But I just love stories.
That's all that's relevant, is what is the road that led you there? And you see the common threads, because you can't yeah. put your mind through that membrane and access some of these realms of understanding, of experience. And there's so many roads that people take. And the search for spirituality is the same exact search that people who are trying to heal themselves from autoimmune diseases are going through. I mean, it's just this probing of the layers of falseness to get down to this, what is the core of this experience? What is real here, and what's going on, and how can I relate more intimately with it and commune with it on a more real level? And of course you can say this to somebody, but they have to take the steps and go through the difficult, fun, adventurous, amazing, exciting work of actually probing and getting to that core, getting to that little seed inside, and kind of, you know, stoking that fire. The last question, we kind of just touched on it there anyways, is, you know, what is health? And I guess what you just said, really lines up with that, but maybe you can expand on that a little bit more.
Health to me is much beyond. You see, a lot of people again take health as the absence of pain and suffering.
You're not dying.
yes. This is the sort of allopathic model now, isn't it? You know, I think health is again. I just have to say again, just reconnecting with who you are. If you have that kind of peace inside, you have that kind of health on an emotional level, so that you're not, it manifests. Some people say, well, what's the point of doing this, sorting out all the emotions? Because it manifests in a way where you're not so touched by everything. You know, I see a lot of people, particularly a lot of spiritual people, if you like, meditators and stuff, they're very delicate people. They get affected by things. They can't watch something on the television that's bad news, or they can't do this, or they can't watch a frightening film, or, you know, imagine not being able to watch The Walking Dead. You know, that's cool. You got to be able to watch The Walking Dead.
That's real.
You can't shy away and go, oh, I can't watch that. It's so.
when you have a daughter in a one-bedroom house, you don't really get much time. You have to be very selective with what you watch. So The Walking Dead, I've never seen.
Sure. But I mean, if you want to, but my point is, if you want to watch, just do anything. It should be a resilience and a flexibility as well. Like the old thing of the oak tree that blows down in the wind, but the blade of grass is still there. Mm. You know, be flexible in life. The ability to be flexible in any situation, so that it doesn't affect you in the way that it did before. Your stress is like water off the duck's back. After a while, you have this kind of
hardening your heart, though. You know what I mean? Like, kind of, you know, putting up this shell and this impermeable barrier. It's different than that.
No, it's exactly the opposite. It's taking away the barriers,
yeah.
So that you realize that everything's one. We're just sense organs of the infinite, if you like. We're not separate entities. We're just an eye looking out at another eye. You know, this is what's happening here. It's just consciousness talking to consciousness. And yet on this level, there's the paradox that it's Tristan and it's Phil and we're having this chat. But we're just the same organism, really. We've sort of warped time here with Skype or this Zoom thing. And once you see that, nothing else can be taken particularly seriously. I think people who get very upset about things, stressed about things quickly, nothing's that serious. Nothing's really that serious when it comes down to it. And even the serious things are not as serious as we thought. It doesn't mean to say that makes it sound like you become some total imbecile, but actually
it makes it sound like it's this hippy dippy thing of like, woo, flowers and rainbows, doesn't matter. Nothing matters.
No, because they always thought the hippie thing was great, but they thought that flowers and the rainbows were great, but so was the mud and the thunderstorms. You know, that's cool too. We need to go beyond the hippie idea, which was a stepping stone to it. I think it opened up a lot of people's consciousness, but it's a matter of not looking for the flowers and the rainbows all the time. There's going to be horrible weather. There's going to be all kinds of stuff, and it's being flexible enough that the next time that comes, you look at it and you go, there's going to be a silver lining to this. It's okay. Just chill out, watch what happens. And generally that makes it pass quicker. And that to me is health, because, or a symptom of health, because it makes you far less likely to get sick in the first place. You're not going to get sick again. And you lose the fear of getting sick. So many people are thinking, well, when am I going to get sick? Because they don't understand the myriad of things that make them sick. Once you understand that and take them away, take the bad emotions away, defuse them, reframe them, take the bad food away, whatever that bad food might be for you, listening to your body, you'll find out. And that might change from month to month. Mm-hmm. You know, take away the fear of everything happening, all the nasty stuff happening. Then you have health, I'd say. You have flexibility, health, and hopefully that stops you ever having any of these horrendous ailments again.
Yeah, that's funny. There's always this paradox and everything, right? Because you mentioned earlier it's about submission, but it's not about submission to the system. It's not about submission to the disease. It's about submission to the process that this is kind of a healing. Yeah. And in the end, you do have to, it becomes kind of a battle where it's like, okay, I have this desire to line myself up with a more honest way of living, a better way of living, a better way of going about this and dealing with this. And I am going to fight against my laziness and the habits that got me here. And I have to build up some energy and say no to this. Kind of, you know, it's this funny paradox always, because it's about submission, but it's also about battling. But if you battle in the wrong way, you're battling against yourself, and you're just, you know, and then also
it's a fine line.
It's about looking for the silver lining, but not getting addicted to this feeling of like warm and fuzzy at the silver lining. You know, it's like, you gotta realize, okay, this thunderstorm, this is hardcore. I got to kind of battle this leak in my roof and plug the holes here and there. But I know that after this rain, my garden's going to be flourishing and the flowers are going to be beautiful and it's going to be feel charged and it's going to smell amazing outside. So,
I mean, the thing is, when I say a silver lining, it's not that you get some great reward of all this bliss and happiness at the end. It's often not. Mm-hmm. It's often maybe a stark realization about something appalling in your own character that's been holding you back for years. Something like that might suddenly hit you, and that is a tremendous gift. You know, I think all of the computer is working towards kind of perfecting itself, if you like. And every one of us are these little chips in the computer that help it to do that and help it to kind of look at itself and admire itself and argue with itself and all of these things going on. And that's absolutely fine. And you get some horrendous time that you go through. And it can be just a revelation of something awful in you. Yeah. And that's tremendously valuable too. It's not always that you're rewarded with tremendous bliss, happiness, the perfect partner, all that kind of thing. Addicts for the buzz, the great things. You know, enjoy the whole damn lot. Enjoy the whole lot.
Yeah, this has been an awesome conversation. Well, I'd love to have you on again. I'd love to have on more guests who have, you know, personal healing journeys to share, who have interesting perspectives on how they've been able to deal with some of these harsh reality slaps like autoimmune diseases. And I think it's great the approach that you take and what you're doing through your website, which is what is your website again?
It's pureactivity1word.net. And I hadn't done, you know, I'd only been helping friends out and people who I'd met, friends of friends and people through the whole paleo scene, you know, and it was great. It was rewarding. But what's been great since the Buddha at the Gas Pump interview is having people actually Skyping with me and seeing their journey. Is so rewarding for me. It's lovely because they teach me a load too. You know, people, once you get their intuition going, they come back to you again and again. They say, hey, I've discovered this, and this did this, and this didn't quite do that. And you just get so much knowledge from these people and their wonderful healing journeys too. So you know, if anybody wants to Skype, please do, because I love hearing from you. And it's great when you give me the feedback, because I learn so much from everybody's healing journey. So they're all so different. We're all these different little unique parts of the computer. And it's beautiful to see. It really is. It gives me tremendous confidence too.
Yeah. It's such a, that's like the most rewarding thing, is getting to meet people. And you know what we do with the coaching thing, it's the same. It's like, we feel so gracious that we get to meet all these individuals and kind of see their journeys and see them grow and shed layers and, you know, get, go places where they didn't think that they ever would. But, you know, it's interesting too, when people come to you and it's like, you're, it's almost kind of like you're telling them what they already know sometimes. And you're like,
look,
your conscience has been telling you this already. And like, I'm just the mouthpiece for you right now. So it's,
yeah, but they're not trusting their intuition. Yeah, they're not trusting their intuition. It's great to see, because you see them, it's like, oh, that's so obvious. That's great. You know, like, I knew that anyway.
I thought that that might be the case. This nagging fear and all this was still, yeah, it's an interesting process. So, yeah. So pureactivity.net is Phil's website. It's been awesome having Phil on. Love to have him on again. Could have talked for hours. Any last words for the audience?
Just, if you have something autoimmune, since that seems to have been what this is about, just please don't get that despair. Don't get caught up in the huge despair. Your body didn't always do that. It can learn to be okay again, you know, but there's ways that you have to look beyond it to come back down to that. You have to go really deep into it. It's not just a physical thing. There's no magic bullet, but it's a really rewarding journey. I'm excited for you.
All right.
Enjoy it. It'll be cool.
All right. So you can find more of this at www.primaledgehealth.com. And I'll talk to you guys next time.